Hello, I'm Mark.
And I'm Evan.
And you're listening to Talks with Joe podcast. Two youth pastors just talking about youth ministry stuff for your enjoyment and pleasure and hopefully benefit.
Two youth pastors, two states, one subject.
700 miles.
700 miles away.
Welcome back, dude. This is episode number two via my awesome, cool new microphone and this really sweet setup.
That is true. That it would be the second episode of video as well as...
Dude, you're wearing the same clothes you wore in the last one.
I know. So Ew. Are you. This is gross, man. Ew. Why would you do that?
Dude, I think didn't you wear those clothes the day after yesterday?
Yes. You scared me there for a second. We're on this would be episode number 15, the 1-5.
Wow, the big 1-5.
The big 1-5.
Which is cool because today also marks 15 years of friendship between you and I.
15 years of friendship.
Right. Something like that. Something like that. Dude, I got to tell you a story from my retreat last weekend.
All right. Well, give them a debrief of what this retreat is and stuff like that.
This is our fall retreat. It's a huge weekend for kind of laying out the course of the year. Usually whatever theme we talk about on fall retreat seems to be something that we come back to a lot during the year at certain points. But it's huge for the freshmen and feeling part of the group and stuff like that. So I tried something totally different this year, and we did a lip sync / karaoke battle the last night. Did you see any of the live footage from it?
I didn't see any of the live footage, but I saw some of the recap footage.
Dude, it was magical. It was so amazing. It was so phenomenal. Seeing them get up there and just be clever and creative and hilarious. It was phenomenal. One of the highlights was Dora and Sage up on the stage singing "Can You Feel the Love Tonight?" and everyone standing up and linking arms and swaying back and forth and singing along, get to the chorus, and it was just this giant sing along with all these people singing. It was gold. It was magic. It was so awesome. And that came after a really cool, like, God moment for our whole group. So we had been talking over the weekend about our worship and the offering that we bring to God. And, you know, what are you offering? We all offer something. What is your offering of worship to God? And we talked about how our offering needs to be acceptable and what that means and how our offering is with our whole life and worship is our whole life. And the last night, getting to the end of Colossians 3, it talks in everything you do, word or deed, do it all for the glory of God, and talking about all that, and the whole thing built to this place of saying, and this is your offering, you know, what are you going to give? And so we put helium in like 60 balloons or whatever, and had them write down on the balloons what their offering is to God. And then they walked out the chapel doors, and we had leaders there who had cut open glow sticks and just drenched each of the balloons with the glow of it, which was almost looked like blood on it, like a sacrifice, right. A little bit, which actually Sarah, when she was cutting it open, she cut her finger. So we joked that she was like sprinkling blood on there too, just to make the offering, you know. So we all go out into the field, right? And you look up and there's all these stars, like just an incredible display of stars, just amazing, which was cool because that was part of the logo that I made for the weekend was stars in the background over like sort of the logo that I did. And so it looks like the background to the logo that I made. And I'm thinking that, and I'm like, wow, this is really cool. So we all have our balloons and I pray. And then when I say amen, we all let go of these glowing white balloons and there's a full moon out and
that's cool.
Just each of the balloons just lit up in the sky as it goes up. And then they're all like, you know, 150 feet up in the air, and a shooting star just goes across the sky. And everyone was like, what? Like, that's so cool. And it was sweet. So after that, then we had small groups and some downtime, and then we did a late night karaoke and lip sync, and people were just being silly. One of the guys had me laughing so hard, I was literally crying because I was laughing so hard.
Which one was it? Was it the Frozen guys?
No, they were really good too. But it was, well, it was one of them. It was Matt Salmonson.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure you've seen it because you're very into the world of YouTube. But the Epic Sax guy.
Oh, yeah, where he goes in like malls and plays the same saxophone.
Yeah, one of the songs from there, I haven't seen it, but the one of the songs from there, he just a little excerpt, and he went up there and he was just like kind of dancing and pretending like he was playing saxophone. But it's just like the same 5 seconds repeated over and over. And what I didn't realize was the clip is 10 hours long.
Oh, my God.
And he was just prepared, which stay tuned. I'm doing a little day trip driving tomorrow, and I'm going to go live just listening to that as I'm driving. That's going to motivate me. But he was prepared to go as long as we let him go. No one was stopping him. So we're all just like sitting there and like trying to get into it. And he just keeps going and going and going and going. And he's doing the same. He's just jumping around like this. He's not even doing anything extravagant. And then it clicks in my mind. I was like, I know what he's doing. He's just going to be up there as long as we let him be up there. And I lost it, man. I was laughing so hard.
That's so
and then
good.
I sent other guys up there. I was like, just go up there and dance with them. Someone's got to break this up. And, at the end of that, yeah, I was laughing so hard, I started to cry.
Oh my gosh.
So, it was sweet.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
That's completely amazing.
So what's new on the radar? You guys don't do a fall retreat, right? You guys do a winter?
No, we do a districts conference, the cool thing now is we are technically a part of one denomination. You're EFCA, I'm EFCA, but you guys are the rebel church because you don't do districts. But we do districts, so that we're in the Northern Plains district, so that's our little sliver of Minnesota in the Northwest, which is about like, I think, total of 4 churches in Minnesota, and then all of the North Dakota and South Dakota churches meet in Aberdeen, South Dakota, which is about 6 hours away. We all pile in this hotel, and that's our district's conference. So it's not really like a retreat or anything. It's conference.
And when is that?
That is in March. They, from what I've been told, is that they've never committed to a certain weekend every year. They've just adjusted it all the time. Some years it's in January, some years it's in February, some years it's in March. This year it's in March. So it'll be my first district's conference.
That sounds cool.
Next year.
That sounds really cool.
Yep. And we let all 7th through 12th graders go. So it's not just high school. It's everybody.
Yeah. Well, that's great, man. It's always interesting to see how different people do youth ministry differently in different parts of the country. You know, like creating districts and getting together yearly like that. I think that's really sweet.
Yeah. And I think, like, I know we talked about like conferences and stuff like that, and we've kind of always had this sour taste in our mouth, but what's changed, my perspective has changed a tiny bit on conferences. I'm still leery about them, but what I have to remember is that with students in the city, they're always around people all the time. So going to another event with a lot of people to them is kind of like, this is just like home. This isn't really different.
That's a really good point, man.
But with these farm students and small town, it's like they don't get that ever.
Yeah.
So for them to actually see people from different states, different cities, that's exciting to them. And that's where their eyes are like, God's bigger than my little hometown in New Fulton, Minnesota. Yeah, he is. So that's a cool thing about it. And that's where, when we're going to be doing challenge this year, that's why I wasn't so hesitant about it. Cause it's like, no, these students are always excited for this cause they never get to do something like this.
Yeah.
The most that they know, because the town I live in is 368 people. That's total people, not just teenagers. I think this whole school, which is, it goes to Thief River, which is 20 minutes south, to Greenbush, which is 45 minutes north. So that's the reach. And that's about 200 students. So for them to get out of their whole area is just awesome. So I'm really looking forward to seeing that. And yeah, it's good.
I think that's great. I think that that's a really good perspective on it, with like country versus city.
Yeah.
And stuff like that. Well, I hope that that's great. And
yeah, it was a really
weekend for us last weekend. And
the negative part about Challenge, it's in Kansas City, Missouri, and every conference of 1,000+ people is always in the most humid city. I don't understand that. Go to somewhere where it's cold so you can all warm each other up instead of sweat together.
It's so hot!
Yeah, Kansas City. I was kind of surprised by the move of the EFCA to go back there, because they were there 4 years ago, and I was there for it, and I didn't feel like it was the best layout really for a conference. So
it's not.
I was kind of surprised. I love the venue that it was actually in, but the hotels were pretty far, and it was busing, and the parking for
interesting
was pretty far too. So
because this year they're not doing far. I think all of the hotels are within like a 2-block radius.
That makes okay. Then that would. That would change my opinion of it, because you had to wait for buses for a while, and there was me and a couple students missed the bus one night, so then we had to walk.
You
back.
You had to walk back for a mile
and stuff. So
a mile up in our kind of temperaments is nothing, but a mile in Kansas City is horrid.
Yeah,
it's horrible.
Yeah,
even 10 minutes outside in Kansas City is horrible. You think the night cools down? I feel like the night just heats everything up.
Yeah.
Well,
hey, that wasn't as bad as when it was in New Orleans two years prior to that. New Orleans. Rochelle could tell you about that. Rochelle was there for that. That was hot.
Yeah.
That was hot.
Well, that's where we had our missions trip this summer.
Oh yeah. That's
in
right.
New Orleans. Yeah. That was it. Yeah. I did not like the weather.
It's a different kind of humid down there.
And how much coffee those people drink down there. I'm like, how do you do this? Like, I can't even think about coffee right now.
Yeah, I drink hot coffee even when it's super hot.
Yeah, but then you regret it later because you get the back sweats all the time.
Okay.
At least I do.
Maybe not what I
Maybe
was
Maybe that's just me.
But, okay. Hey, let's jump into our topic, though.
Yeah, let's do it.
For today, we realized as we were chatting before we came on that we actually are in the midst of working through the same kind of series, and that's trying to teach and talk and instruct about dating, which we know to be an important topic, and a topic that maybe people link together with purity a lot, but there's a lot to be said just about dating. And even though dating is not necessarily something that you can say, all right, turning your Bibles to
right. This.
And that's, so there's a couple things about this discussion that I think we need to hit. One is how are you going to approach dating and using the Bible, and how you're going to do a series kind of on that. But then also, I think maybe where we start is what's at stake. Why do we talk about this? And what do we see at stake? What's the, I guess, importance of it?
Yeah. Sorry, I'm just opening up my Word document.
Oh, you got notes, man?
I don't have notes. It's just a schedule.
Yeah. I mean, one thing that is at stake here is dating, or pursuit of dating, takes up a lot of mind space of a high school or even junior high student. They're thinking a lot about what others think about them. And so to help them think about that in a biblical God, I think really a God honoring way is how I would phrase it. Like, to help them think about that in a God honoring way is really important, because it's such a big thing that they're thinking about right now. That's one thing to have at stake.
Yeah. No, I agree. It's also one of those things where, like, it's either really talked about at home or it's not talked about at home. I don't think I've ever heard of a medium ground. And so a lot of times, even with the ones that talk about it a lot, they're still like, I don't get it. I don't understand what, how do I navigate dating?
Solid Christian students say, I've heard my whole life not to date a non-Christian, but I don't understand why.
Yeah.
And it's like, what? Okay. Or, I mean, some of them would say, I know why, I just don't want to choose that. Okay. Yeah. Well, then that's another element of it.
Yeah.
Some would say, like, just what's the reason? Like, why can't I missionary date? Like, why is that a bad idea? Or why, you know? So, yeah, I mean, some families have these set up times where they're talking about it and some don't. And then their view of dating is really formed by culture and music and which is sad, man. Do you see that? Do you encounter that with your students sometimes where view of dating or relationships maybe is just very secular?
I would say so. But yeah, I would say so. It's very like, well, this is how a relationship is depicted in The Office. This is how a relationship is depicted on this TV show. This is how Taylor Swift depicts relationships. Men are pigs.
When guys are or girls are receiving self-worth from yeah. who they're dating or who likes them, well, that's
yeah.
That becomes a matter of how secular world is presenting it. When they're doing things, obviously, in the context of that relationship that are not honoring to God, that's a lie that they've believed from the world and from music, that's not only acceptable in the dating relationship, but it's also beneficial for a dating relationship. You know, that's a problem. There's a lot of ways that you know, students can think about a relationship really from not a God honoring perspective, all the way down to like who they date and how casually they
right.
date. It's like, well, I'm dating this person 1 week and I'm going to break up with them because there's this other person who likes me and I'm
right.
going to date that. And it's like, well, what are you doing?
Right.
Why are you? So that's a huge thing. I mean, to try to mold and shape how they think about it and how they approach it, because we don't know who else is really talking to them about it.
Yeah. And the other thing with that is then I think within every dating topic and topical series that you do, which I think is if I'm a guy that's going to say, preach the word as your steady diet with your students. Make sure that you're going through scripture verse by verse, helping them understand, showing them how it points to Jesus. That's so important. But there also needs to be a break from the diet for a while to do a topical series. And I think dating is one of those series that needs to be topical because you have to do it topically.
Yeah.
And that's one of the biggest ones where it's like, okay, we've had this steady diet of going through the word consistently, like how you're going through Acts and I'm currently going through the Sermon on the Mount. Now I want to break from that. Once we're finished, I want to break from that to get to this topical series of dating. And I think in that topical series, usually to end it is talking about marriage and dating in the light of marriage. And what does marriage actually mean? And why do we date with marriage in mind? What does that even mean to date with marriage in mind? Because a lot of people have interpreted, oh, I'm dating to marry. So that means I can have sex with them. I can tell them I love you as much as I want. I can do whatever I want. Because basically it's a covenant relationship. It's a prerequisite to the covenant relationship is how I've seen students view it. Where, oh, they're my boyfriend. That it's this covenant relationship when the dating relationship is not. Marriage is the only covenant relationship. And it's a problem when people have idolized dating over the marriage relationship. Dating is to lead us to that. It's not to represent or take place of marriage.
Yeah, I think that that's good. And that gets a little bit into the how we present it. I mean, I think we know it's important and we right. have to address it in some way. Before we get into that, how you're planning on doing it and how I'm planning on doing it, question for you. Have you done anything to notify parents? Do you see that as being sensitive area to go to them and say, yes. Hey, this is the topic we're talking about?
Yes. So right now in the fall semester, we're just going to go through the Sermon on the Mount. I have it planned all the way till December 6th or something like that. We're going through the Sermon on the Mount fairly slow, but that's okay. And what I told parents in our meeting before school started is I'm looking at talking about dating. It was so interesting to see how they all responded. They're all like, don't like that. And I wouldn't expect nothing less, but I told them, I said, hey, just so you know, I'm thinking about this. And if we do this, I'm going to call for another personal meeting. So you guys know what we're going to be doing. You guys will have a layout of what we're doing. And that's kind of the story with it. One of the things is I think it's really important for us to communicate with parents on what we're talking about, even like each week, saying we're going to hit on this week, we're going to hit on this week. It could switch up, but these are the areas we're going to hit on. Like we're going to hit on saying I love you. We're going to hit on what a dating relationship conduct looks like. We're going to be hitting on this. We're going to be hitting on that. And with the dating series that I'm trying to plan, the very first week that I'm going to talk on is out of Colossians 3:20, children, your parents, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. And titling it, my parents are unfair. They don't let me date, or they're not, something in those lines of how whatever I say is not to supersede parents in this way where a student says, well, the youth pastor gave me a free pass to do this. No, I'll never say that. I'm trying to show them this is what scripture says about dating. Maybe it doesn't say dating clearly, but scripture also says you have to obey your parents. So if your parents are saying don't date, you have to listen to them. You have to obey what your parents are saying, and giving them the reason why is, guys, your parents are your guardians spiritually and physically. They have been assigned by God to care for your soul.
Well, how do you honor God in your relationship if the first thing you do in your relationship is disobey your parents?
Exactly.
How do you, especially, I've had this conversation with people before, like, if you're hiding it from your parents, like, that's a whole new layer of it. Like, you're literally lying.
Right.
About the relationship. It's a really bad start to right. a relationship if you're lying about yeah. what it is. And that's why, I'm with you on that. I think that that's so important. I'm trying to think. I think I put in a parent's email that I was doing a series. I'm doing it on our Sunday morning, like our Sunday school time, on marriage. I think I put it in there. And if I didn't, I've only done 1 week and I haven't gotten into any specifics on dating or anything like that. So I should probably send it out my email this week and just say, hey, this is kind of why I'm doing it and this is where I'm going. But I do think it is important to let parents know, and also to let my leaders know too. Like, hey, you might start to get more questions on this, or we all need to be on the same page. It's always rough when a leader will
go rogue.
Yeah, you go rogue. It's like, oh no, like, you know, don't go there, don't say that or whatever. But that's good. Okay, so we see the importance of it. We want to set it up well with talking to parents and leaders. Let's dive into a little bit how we're going to talk about this in a way that hopefully accomplishes kind of that first category of why it's important. what are you going to do to make this effective for what we're trying to aim at?
One of the big things I would say is kind of how they're what I've seen, especially in young men and young women, is they don't know how to act around the opposite gender. I've seen guys not be afraid to slap a girl's butt in public. I've seen guys use profane language to describe a girl. I've seen girls casually talk about using guys with their looks or with kisses or something like that to get what they want. I've seen this whole misconduct, and I think that's what I want to be hitting on. It's this age of complete permission that anything goes, and guys always want it and girls always want it. So therefore everybody wants it and everybody's going to get it from that person.
And the casualness of that,
yes,
I think is what's alarming. When, yes, when you take something as serious as this, because I do think that this is a major area of fighting temptation and growing in godliness and stuff like that, and mm-hmm. honoring God, as casually as some of how it's seen it handled. Yeah, that's alarming. And while I haven't seen some of the stuff that you were mentioning, I think some of the casual, for sure, how people talk, for right. sure, and that's not just a guy issue. I think sometimes,
yes,
it's easy to label guys as like, guys talk disgusting about girls, and it's like, okay, well,
girls talk just as disgusting as guys.
Well, I think it's different. I think they probably talk differently about, at least, you know, it's so hard because I'm not like around it in the same way, but
right,
I think it's possible, and this is drawing on even when I was in high school in some ways, or when, you know, experience over the course of the last 12 years of working in youth ministry. Like, sometimes girls can objectify guys too.
Oh yeah.
And girls can have bad motives for a relationship, and girls. Right. So there's a lot with that needs to be addressed. And I think how my strategy for it is kind of going, I think it's serious, and I think it's really important to think about these things. So one of the best things I think I could do is go as serious as I could possibly go with them. And so the series isn't really on dating, even though that's how I keep applying stuff, is into dating. Really, the series is on marriage. If I can sculpt a view of marriage that is biblical and right and how God ordained it to be, then that immediately becomes the target that everyone is looking at when right. they think about marriage. So when they're thinking about someone they're going to date, they're like, okay, I know what dating is for, and I know what marriage is, and it's crazy to even think about myself as one with this person. Yeah. And so I've kind of gone about it trying to make it as serious as I can. It sounds like that's where you were going with it too. Earlier you said yeah. that.
Yeah. That was what I'm looking at right now with what I had. That was going to be my last message out of the series. But now that you say that, I think that needs to be the first one. And then move into with the parents' rule. Like, what's the point of dating? Why bother? And say, this is the goal. It's in marriage. And then that way, every message that comes after that, it's easier to apply that to. Like, that's the goal, is marriage, guys. That's the goal. And if you're doing this, you're distracting yourself from something so beautiful, so pure, so wonderful, that represents God's love for his people.
As we've talked about dating with students over the years, it's interesting because, you know, some of them, it's just very clear that they're not in a place maturity wise to even be thinking about it. And when you can start laying out the seriousness of what a dating relationship is and what And the purposes of even dating. That's a big part of it. There's so many elements to hit with it. But I'm going to start with marriage. I showed up to teaching. I've only done 1 week so far, but I showed up with Pastor Brad here has a premarital counseling like handbook that he's kind of written. And so I showed up with that. I was like, hey guys, we're going to go through our premarital counseling stuff. And, we're going to talk about, because in there he lays out so well what marriage is and the design of it and the purpose. So my intention with that is a couple of things. One, you're going to see the purpose of marriage, which hopefully helps you see the importance of who you date and how you date and what you're looking for as you date someone. So yeah, there's not passages on, and when you date, make sure you're not going to get that, but we do see a lot about marriage. And I think that that's going to help, help tremendously in just their view of who they're interested in and why they're interested in how they're pursuing that and all that stuff. I think too, eventually, you always hear like God-centered relationship and dating relationship. I want to help flesh that out and what that would look like. Eventually, one day you guys will be in a dating relationship, Lord willing, or a marriage, Lord willing. And what does that look like to be God-honoring in that? What does God-centered mean very practically? And I think practically, one of the best ways that you can do that is making sure that the other person is not living in sin. And that your relationship is not leading into sin, and also that each of you on your own are pursuing God in the ways that you should be pursuing God. So,
1 Timothy 5:1-2 comes to mind when you say that.
Why don't you read it out?
Yeah, let me find it in my Moody Bible, because no Bible like a Moody Bible.
That's what I hear.
Yeah. So 1 Timothy 5:1-2, do not rebuke an older man, but encourage him as you would a father, younger men as brothers, older women as mothers, younger women as sisters, in all purity.
Can you read that one more time? I was checking our Instagram because people are writing messages.
Yeah, I can read it one more time. Let me find it. I'll wait till you're ready to listen.
All right, go ahead. And we have a message then of someone writing in.
All right. Here it is. Do not rebuke an older man, but encourage him as you would a father, younger men as brothers, older women as mothers, younger women as sisters, in all purity.
That's great.
I think that hits it where it's like, how do you conduct yourself around guys and girls? You encourage each other in all purity. That means you are disgusted by sin in your life as well as their life. And you guys consistently, and they're like, well, what's the difference of that being a Christian friendship? No, there's no difference, really. That's the thing. Dating is a more, I would use the word focused friendship on someone of the opposite gender, but it is not covenant.
Right.
It's not a saying where it's like, it's open, do whatever you want with them, go to someone else if you want to. Because how can you be trustworthy in that dating relationship if you're going to do that?
Right. That's a character thing there.
Yeah.
That's a character thing there. I think that, I lost what I was going to say. I was going to jump on that with something, but keep going with what you're saying.
Yeah. And the thing is that you don't hold a dating relationship like a marriage. A marriage is, once you're a husband, you have a completely different task. I mean, you still hold your wife and encourage her in all purity, but you are called to love her as Christ loved the church. You're called to serve her. You're called to lead by serving and serve by leading. That's what a husband is called to do. Boyfriend isn't called to be a husband. Boyfriend isn't called to say, okay, by the way, you're to love your girlfriend in this covenant relationship as Christ loved the church. That's not what Paul says. Paul says husbands love your wives.
That's really important. That's really important, especially because I think sometimes people want, in the context of a dating relationship,
yes,
for it to look like a marriage, like the guy is supposed to be leading spiritually in a certain way that they would see that in marriage, or that that there's a time expectation, or you know, sometimes purity wise they go to a place that's impure because they're thinking of it in that seriousness of a way.
Yeah.
But it really, somehow as we teach it, we have to align it with, this is all with marriage in mind. So yes, if you're going to set your marriage up right, you're going to want whoever you're dating to really be as focused as they can be in pursuing Christ as much as they can. Because that's who you want to become one with. You're not becoming one with someone that as you're dating.
Yeah.
You're not one with them at all. And if at any point along the process of dating, you're seeing something that you wouldn't want to make one with you, then that's reason to separate. But I think it's hard for people to do that because they've already viewed it as some sort of a covenant. You know, people have said, well, what does it look like to lead within the context of this dating relationship? You know, a guy will ask me that. And I'm like, well, first of all, it's not your responsibility to husband her. You're not, you're not that right now. You are a brother in Christ. That's what you are.
Yep.
You're a, you, and I think that's one of the best ways we could view a girlfriend, as our sister, which is kind of weird if you're thinking about it just in a totally secular mindset. But like, as my sister in Christ, I want the best for her. I'm not going to want impurity there. I'm going to want her growing in God. I'm going to want someone safe by her who's going to protect her and care about things of God.
Mm-hmm.
Those are things to lift up. And if you're doing those things, you're fulfilling your role as a brother in Christ. That's your role as you're dating. You're a brother in Christ.
Encourage them in all purity.
And you're doing something very, exactly. And you're doing something very serious because you're pursuing something more serious in marriage.
Yep.
But you have to, you cannot tread on the ground of, you can't pretend like you're married when you're not, and still expect to be moving in a good way. I think sometimes people think if we look like a married couple, then we must be doing dating right. And that's not necessarily true.
Right. Well, and that's the other thing is with what you're saying is like, you're fulfilling your role as a brother in Christ. That's so important to say, because guess what? You fulfilling your role doesn't automatically guarantee you husbandship.
Yeah,
it doesn't. But what makes that beautiful is that when it doesn't turn into husbandship, you can both look at each other mutually and said, we did everything we, according to God's word, to the glory of God alone. And that's what our goal was the entire time. See, the problem is with dating today is that it's all about fulfill my needs. And then when something goes wrong, you start to attack the person, and then the breakup happens, and then you see these people fall out of a friendship, and because they see them as not a person who they are called to encourage in all purity, but an object to get something out of. They see them as a...
Yeah, and that's when it starts a vending machine. In a place of like, oh, she's so hot.
Yes.
Or, you know, oh my, you know, he's so hot. Right. And oh, you know, oh, they're talking to me and like this, it's almost like...
It's attention seeking.
I never like to encourage, like really encourage any sort of dating relationship in high school, really.
No.
But there have been times that I've said to a student, hey, I know you like this person and I've heard the way you talk about it and I appreciate the way you talk about it because you're talking about character and it seems like you're drawn to the right things. I want to read something that we got in from a former student of mine.
Okay.
Emma, she said, the pastor at my church is actually doing a series on dating and marriage right now. On Sunday, he quoted somebody, I can't remember who it was, and said that marriage should be our loudest gospel message. And I thought that that was really powerful.
Yeah.
So she's saying, my question out there was, if you were going to be doing a series and teaching on marriage, what would you want to say? And she's saying, well, I would want to say that it's our loudest gospel representation. I think that that is so good, Emma. Yeah. And I think that that really plays into what we would want to say to someone right now is,
right.
is okay, you're dating with the intention of marriage, which should be your loudest expression of the gospel. I mean, just right. think about the plurality, but one. It's like an expression yeah. of God's essence. Marriage is, you know, there's two, but they become one. And we're supposed to love each other, how Christ loves the church, and the gospel is played out in that way. And
right. Well, and you think about it too.
There's so much gospel there. If you can't see yourself living out the gospel super well with someone, that's a huge reason for even dating someone who's a Christian.
Right.
You know, that's a huge reason of saying, well, this is one reason why you date someone who's a Christian, because
right.
if you can't see yourself down the line as this is a great one of the greatest ways that you can really demonstrate the gospel.
Right.
Then what are you doing now? What are you seeing about this that looks good for marriage? If you cannot display the gospel now in this relationship, what makes you say that you're going to display that later on in life? And furthermore, I'm going to go beyond just this as a demonstration of other people about the gospel. But as I talk to students, when their parents' marriage is not in a good place, that's a huge turnoff to them, sometimes about marriage, but sometimes just about the gospel and about the church right. and about Christ in general. When they don't see it working in home, in their home, they're that much less likely to make that part of it makes it easier, I should say, for them to reject it for their own life. So, Emma, I think you're right. I think that that's a huge yep. thing to say is this is about the gospel. And so when right. you're dating, the gospel should be seen. You should be able to play that out later on in life. It's like you should be able to imagine this relationship in marriage and honoring God and displaying the gospel. But
yeah.
it's not like you live in that now. You're not in that right. reality now.
Yeah. And
there's so many ways to talk about even how to do dating in an honoring way. I mean, you said, listen to your parents. You know, if your parents are against it, don't. Obviously,
I think it's and with that, I think it's fair for a student to ask their parent, okay, can you tell me why? Like, it could be and I think the other thing is, like, I think of myself as a parent, I want to be ready to answer my son, like, why do you have these rules for me when dating? Okay, let me tell you why, instead of saying, like, well, I'm your parent, so I just say so. Student's not going to like that. That's where the rebellion comes in. I mean, that's what I did after my parents said, well, we told you so. Well, then I'm going to rebel because I don't have a good enough reason.
Right.
And with that, the other thing that I have told students in the past is when you're not dating now, like, because I said, I don't know what you're going to be doing in your dating life. I'm going to encourage you not to do it when you're in high school, but you're probably not going to listen to me. So if you're not dating now, what I'm going to ask is that you seek God more than anything in your life right now. So that when that person comes along that you are going to wind up dating, they have to search for God.
Yeah.
They have to desire God so much in order to actually develop a strong relationship with you.
And how important is that too, Evan, with how often a dating relationship in high school turns out to be a major distraction from their relationship with God.
Yep.
Someone that is receiving, in some cases, worship, really, like just demonstration of love and adoration and honor and time and all these things that are given that are really stopping you from being who you're supposed to be.
Right.
That's another major thing to talk about in regards to doing this right. Jacob is waving at me right now. I don't think he wants to come in and weigh in on this one.
Probably
duck,
not.
Gray duck is probably easier to weigh in on than Jacob. What would you say about dating and marriage? But yeah, I just think that that's another part of the discussion there. So there's a lot to say on it, but I think what we're both agreeing on is really emphasizing the marriage. Really emphasizing
a gospel presentation.
Yeah, and what the relationship is and what it isn't, and also, yeah, the gospel, and that should be played out. If my battery is running low.
Mine's getting close there too. Get your charger, man. He has left us for this time, but we're going to move into NPR Radio, Thought for Your Thoughts. We're going to ask you this thought. I can't think of one.
Well, I think that's been good, man. Maybe we can wrap up with there we go. Boom. I'm back. I have a technology tip.
Technology tip. I want to
put that out there.
Techno tip.
Dude, I have a technology tip.
Tech tip.
Can you believe it? Tip. I mean, sometimes we do that, right? Sometimes at the end of an episode, we'd say, hey, check this out. Use this. I might have actually used this one before, but I'm going to reuse it because I did something different with it. And I think it's a design app called Over.
Nope. You've never done this one before.
OVER. The app is yellow with a big O in it. And it has revolutionized my design game.
Is that how you made the fall retreat?
It is how I made the fall retreat. And also our fall series that we've been going on, the Book of Acts. I did that one there too. I had it before for the longest time, and it was just a free app that I was using, but I decided to try 1 month, the $8 per month. And it just opened up so many resources and tools and pictures and different tools that I can actually design stuff.
Cool.
And it doesn't take that long. I don't want to be spending a ton of time on stuff like that.
Right.
But I think it does matter, and it does make a difference when you do have stuff like that. And it's an image to identify with. And so that's been a great tool and resource. It's not that hard to use. I started really simple, and I think I'm still probably really simple, but I think I'm getting better at it.
Well, that's the other thing is with logos, students don't want the freaky, crazy stuff. The more simple and aesthetic stuff is more pleasing to them. Hipster generation.
And that's a good thing for millennial, a simple guy like me.
Exactly.
Sweet, man.
Well, I don't have a tech tip, but I have a game tip.
Dude, game tip.
I got a game tip. So get some bubble gum, some double bubble. Get a big bucket of it. Bring it to youth group and start bubble gum trivia. How you play this game is you have to come up with a bunch of different questions, just simple questions, not multiple choice, just easy ones like what color is the sky, who's better, Packers or Bears, easy questions just like that. And what you'll do is you'll have two students come up. You ask them the question. You give them 10 seconds to answer. If none of them answer in 10 seconds, they both have to take a piece of bubblegum and chew it. Do not swallow, only chew. But if someone wants to answer, they raise their hand, however you want to run that, they answer. If they get it right, their opponent has to take a piece of bubblegum and chew it. If they get it wrong, they have to take a piece of bubblegum and chew it. And then if they get it wrong, the opponent gets a chance to answer. If the opponent gets it right, the other person has to take a piece of bubblegum and chew it. If they get it wrong, they have to take a piece of bubblegum and chew it. It keeps on going until you cannot understand their answer, or they start drooling pink bubblegum sludge from their mouth.
I love it. I think that's entertaining.
It works.
As long as no one chokes, I love it.
Usually if they're chewing it, they're so focused on keeping it in their mouth. That's the other part of it. Make sure that they're chewing it and not swallowing it, because that will prevent choking. And by the time it gets that nasty softball sock that you're chewing on, they don't really want to swallow it. They just want to spit it out.
Yeah, for sure.
We played that game last night, and the girl that we did guys versus girls, because they actually really like that type of game where the guys win or the girls win. And the girl had braces on.
Oh no.
And she had it. So the guys, we said, okay, let's see how big like the bubble gum mound is. So they spit it out into this little like takeout box. So the guy spits it out. It's this nice softball size. It's huge. And then the girl's like, okay, hold on 1 second. So she goes, and then just starts pulling it out with just yards and yards of bubble gum. And we're all just sitting there saying, girls went on that one because that's just gross.
Oh,
and there was, she was still like the rest of the night, she was still chewing. So there, it wasn't all gone. There was still some in her mouth.
Oh, it was hilarious. That's really nasty.
So there you go. And if they're quick with it, you could get it done in like 10 minutes. And it's entertaining because then everybody else watching gets to see these two people have to chew on a sock. It's great.
That's awesome, dude. That's a good game. That's a good addition. That's a solid, solid game to just bust out at any time or, exactly. or maybe even like on a retreat or something like that. That'd be a good time. So,
and if you're smart, you get the 380 piece.
There's the pro tip.
You get the 380 piece. That's how many games?
Yeah.
That's like 200 games. I'm kidding. But it's a lot of games. That's at least 100.
Definitely not 200 games, but that is a lot of games. That's good stuff. Well, we hope you found this conversation beneficial on addressing dating in your teaching to your group. If you would like to join the conversation, there's a couple ways that you can. You can email us at
talkswithjoe@gmail.com.
talkswithjoe@gmail.com. You can also tweet us at talkswithjoe. Also, today I put out on
Instagram. Don't forget Facebook.
Yeah, Facebook. We're on Facebook as well. I also put out on Instagram today. So if you want to follow me at MarkShoemaker3 and Evan, you are
Evan Salibi.
Evan Salibi,
S-A-L-I-B-I.
You can follow us there, and we will occasionally put stuff out with questions when we record. So, anyways, it was good talking with all y'all, and we will talk to you soon. Take magnet.